Well, I'd still consider myself very much working class.
Yeah, thank you. And that, give it me. These swines. Give me that.
I know my circumstances have changed dramatically from when I was growing up in Birkenhead. Now I live in rural Kent, you know, and I've got, I suppose, what people would call a posh house, but as you can see.
Sit.
But it's in me. So, yeah, I'd say I was working class. Shut up! And even more so now. Sorry, it's the dog. Because even back when I started out as a drag queen, class was part of the act. And tight, they're as tight as a crab's arse in the BBC. I'm tight. Lily Savage was very much a working class character. You know, she's from a two up, two down. She's had a bath and a tin bath on a plastic Mac, you know, in front of the fire. She's had an outside lab. But being working class wasn't just about weeing outdoors, oh no. The working class worked. It's right there on the tin. And the work of the working class has shaped this country. From the dark days of the Industrial Revolution to the hairnets and rubber gloves of the factory line, it was the workers that made Britain great.
They were the backbone of the country. Hard-working people, honest people with strong values. And I wonder if they still exist.
Because the working class that I grew up amongst seemed to be virtually extinct. Instead, all I hear about these days is rising hoodies or chavs with too many kids. What happened to those teeming communities of hard-working men and women? Proud of who they were and what they did. Where did it all go wrong for the working class? So I'm starting my journey, as you do, at the very beginning. I was born in the Birkenhead Union Workhouse in the middle of a violent storm. Actually, that's not entirely true, but I just thought a bit of drama might keep you watching. I was born here, but it was long after the workhouse had closed. Oh, come on, you lot, I'm not that old. And I wasn't just born here.
This is St. Catherine's Hospital, and this is where I started work at the age of 9. I had 2 paper rounds and I used to go around all the wards selling the Echo and cigarettes, would you believe? Imagine that now, going around the beds with a little sack full of fags. And this, I seem to remember, was maternity. And I was never allowed to go into maternity, so I used to have to stand outside and go, Echo! And all the women who were heavily pregnant, the waters had burst, so I was brilliant at that, they loved me. My dad died here. My mum was in here with a heart attack. My auntie Chrissy came in with her ulcers and sat in bed and said, see that doctor over there? I'd give him what for this morning. I marked his bloody card for him. And then the doctor would come over to the bed and she'd say, hello, doctor. Just full of it, just full of rubbish. But it's sad to see the old place now. See the laundry's gone and the chimney's gone. And the old workhouse bit's gone. I'll be bloody gone next.
Cheer up, O'Grady, you're not dead yet. And anyway, not all of my family's working past has disappeared. Just 10 miles down the road is the world-famous soap factory Lever Brothers. A Birkenhead institution and one of the most progressive employers around. My granddad Savage worked here for years, and me mum. Even I went for a job here.
Hello.
Hello.
I've come about my job.
Oh, right.
I'm about 40 years too late.
It's never too late.
Actually, I've changed my mind now, love. I don't fancy putting tops on bottles. I'm here to visit their archive and to find out what working life was really like for me granddad Savage.
Whoa, look at this. Oh, I like that very much. Oh, fabulous. Could you get a fortune for these on eBay? Hi, I'm Paul.
Hello, I'm Becky.
Nice. Oh, nice to meet you, Becky.
Oh, Paul, I'm Gavin.
Oh, nice to meet you, Gavin. Look at all this lovely stuff. I mean, this is so familiar to me.
Lifebuoy.
And
yes.
I just love it. Lifebuoy and Coal Tar. But God, that's so evocative of all
that's
sorts.
About 1940.
I wasn't like around then for that. No. That but I remember Lifebuoy soap, a big red block it was.
Yes.
And yeah. Shared collars were done with it.
Mm-hmm.
They used to do all the washing with it. I can see my mother now in the mangle. You know, with sweat running off her. And Mary next door, the same, pegging out air washing, everything gleaming, no washing machines, all done by hand, in a dolly tub with dolly blue bags and Lifebuoy soap. There was a great pride about working at Leavers.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we can see that your granddad considered it a job for life.
Oh, he worked here for years.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how long he worked here.
We can estimate that he started in around 1913, and we have his rate card here. We can see here that he was earning 70 shillings a week, so we converted that, and that's about £113 a week. He'll be earning just under £6,000 a year in today's money. But, yeah, it does seem quite low.
But you were looked after. Here in the factory, they had dentists, doctors,
amazing.
Surgery. They had showers for the women. Quite an innovation in it.
Especially didn't have a crash. They were that forward-thinking. You know what I mean? Bring your children into work, all 15 of them, pile them in that room. You see, Leavers wasn't your average factory. It was the ideal factory. There weren't many better places to find yourself if you were working class, that's for sure. William Leaver was one of a new breed of factory owners, philanthropists who realised that healthy, happy workers with a full set of limbs worked harder for you and made you more money. Clever, eh? I wonder what would happen to me if I'd have got that job.
Who knows? You could be very high up in Unilever now.
I doubt it. I think I'd be down there with the brush. They say, don't talk to him, he's potty. William Leaver didn't just build a factory, he built a whole village. No worries about being late for work here. Named after the most famous soap, Port Sunlight is perfection. My mother would have sold me to the circus for a house in the village. Someone who knows all about life inside and outside the factory walls is Rob Tinkler, who retired from Leavers and then promptly took a job at the local pub. Now there's a work ethic for you. I'm on the pint of whiskey and coke today. I'm cutting my drinking down.
Right.
Now, how long did you work for Leavers for?
Well, I started in Leavers in 1966.
Yeah.
My mum said, Wednesday morning, get to Leavers and get a job.
Yeah.
And that's what it was. I had a medical. Said, where's your birth certificate? I said, oh, I've left it up. You better go and get it. So I should have started at 9 o'clock in the morning. I had to go home to Easton and get my birth certificate. And they started me at 12 o'clock.
And did you like working there?
Yeah. When I worked there, it was fantastic.
Yeah.
There was thousands of people there, see, so we grew up together.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
All the 18-year-olds and they'd all started work. Well, they were all caught and, like, they met the girls in the factory. So everyone you knew, you say, oh, well, that's his girlfriend there, and
oh,
that's
right.
His girlfriend. So you knew who was
coupled
up and
yeah.
All this, you know. So the day I started, I walked down the yard, and I was looking for number three soaps, yeah? And I couldn't find it, and I said, there's this little girl sitting on this bench, and I said, can you tell me where number three soiler soaps are? She said, yeah, it's over there, and that little girl, I married her.
Did you?
In 1969, and I'm still married to her now. I got a house in a village in 1973.
Got her, she in the house now?
Good.
I should have brought her out.
Oh, she doesn't come out.
No, doesn't she? Well, listen, cheers, and good health.
Yeah, thank you very much.
And long may you reign down here in Port Sunlight.
Yeah, I will.
My mother loved working at Leavers factory, and I think that was mainly because of the friendship she made there. The Leavers girls, as she called them. The workplace used to be the heart of every working class community. It gave you a sense of belonging and of knowing where you fitted in. And let's face it, the money came in handy as well. We might not be a nation of factory workers anymore, but you can still find those strong communities if you look for them.
My mother walks in here, my aunt walks in here, my uncle walks in here.
I met my own wife in here as well.
It's a great atmosphere inside the factory.
It is a
as corny as it sounds, a family, that we all care about each other.
When you're all together and you're all friendly and you can have a banter, it makes a difference in your job.
My mother started her working life a long way from the sociable factory floor. She was put into domestic service as a tweeny maid at just 14. And this photo was paid for with her very first wage packet. I've always been fascinated by the world of servants, and by the looks of the TV schedules, so are you lot. My mother's experience of a life in service was nothing like Downton Abbey, though. It was humiliating, monotonous, and akin to slave labour.
Right, yeah. Because my mother, you see, was smart. Yeah, she was always top of the class. And the headmistress, who was a nun, went round to see my mum's auntie Paul, who was looking after her since her own mother had died, to say that she strongly recommended she went on to grammar school because she was highly intelligent. And Auntie Paul, of course, was having none of it, didn't believe in education for young women, and put her in domestic service immediately. My mother worked for a family called the Mulligans in Oxton, and they believed in value for money. You know, they worked them like slaves. She hated it, my mother, absolutely hated it, because she knew she wanted to do different things and she couldn't, because she wasn't given the chance. And what they did, and I always loved this as a kid, because her two sisters worked with her as well. They laid the table for a big dinner party, and they served the first course, brought the kids down into the kitchen, gave them a big pot of jam each to eat and play with, so they were all nasty and sticky, and got out the kitchen window and left them. So Mrs. Mulligan was upstairs ringing a bell for the second course. Savage, because that was my mother's maiden name. And of course, Savage had hopped it out the kitchen window and gone to the Isle of Man. And good luck to her.
So far, I've only blacked a grate and I'm already knackered. The working day of a maid would start before 6 a.m. and she couldn't go to sleep until everyone else was in bed. So I'm stuck down here most of the day doing all the mucky stuff. But I still have to be ready to answer the door whenever anyone calls. Oh, it's a nightmare.
Good morning, sir. Can I ask who's calling, please? The Who? The BBC? Really?
Back in the early part of the last century, there were more people working in domestic service than in any other job. And for the girls, there wasn't really anything else to do, apart from, well, from maybe going on the game. I know what I would have gone for, the one where you flatten your back all day. No matter how hard a maid worked, there was always more to do, and her upstairs was never satisfied.
I mean, look at my lovely grate, gleaming. It's like burnished coal. And look at that teapot. Well, I hope Madam enjoys her tea. I better get the kettle on, haven't I? She'll be ringing in a minute. Good afternoon, madam. Your tea.
Oh.
Just as you like it. Lapsang souchong.
Thank you.
Actually, Jean, can I sit and join you? Because this is killing me.
Sit.
Does this take you back, Jean?
It does.
I was going to say.
Yes, I'm remembering everything.
But
yes.
You were downstairs, though, not upstairs.
Oh, downstairs. Yeah. Oh, yes, absolutely.
Then you can lay out the table.
Yes, Mrs. Bridges.
What are we having today, then, Mrs. Bridges?
A nice piece of roast mutton and onion sauce. What we won't have to worry over for once.
Jean, I loved upstairs, downstairs, and so did everybody else I knew. We didn't go out when it was on. What inspired you?
It was because my mother was a servant, and I wanted it to be about servants. We wanted it, in a way, to be called Downstairs, Upstairs, to show the downstairs in truth.
Corsets top drawer left-hand side, corset laces top drawer right-hand side.
You see, as a viewer watching that programme, it was the below-stairs staff that I empathised with. Like poor old Rose, God love her. I mean, she was so good. She was so honest. She was so hardworking. And I always felt she deserves a better deal in life.
Look, You're not my bleeding father, Mr. Hudson. This is my chance to make something of my life. Something other than endless trundling round this house till I'm too old to walk. And you go and spoil it.
Your mother was in service as well.
Yes. Yeah. She was, first of all, tweeny, you know, that was one of the worst jobs. I mean, I just call them, there's a scrubber.
Yeah.
That was very hard work and endless washing up with soda and, a hot water. And her hands were cracked. It was awful. But that was it. That was her job. And she got used to it.
You see, it seems to me there weren't many opportunities for women then. I mean, the same happened with my mother.
There was nothing else to do.
No.
And you were glad to get the job.
Yeah, because they did try and form a domestic servants union, didn't they, at one time?
And forget it.
Forget it.
You
exactly.
Couldn't.
You couldn't. Yeah.
No way.
You see, working in service only reinforced the class divisions. The idea that Jack was definitely not as good as his master. It was only when working service began to decline that the working classes finally came together to become a political force, and a force to be reckoned with at that. Membership of the trade unions and the newly formed Labour Party boomed in the first decades of the 20th century. Now, would you say you were upstairs or downstairs today?
As a real person?
Yes, as a real person.
I would say I'm classless, really,
yeah.
Because I am, of course, from downstairs. I left school when I was 14.
I remember, as my mum saying, you know, oh, look at that beautiful house, Mum. Wouldn't you love a house like that? She said, there's only two ways you're going to end up in the house, love. One, if you're cleaning it, or if you're breaking in.
Did you?
Yeah, yeah. My mother did a bunk to the Isle of Man in 1931, which was a pretty bleak time to be working class and out of work. The Wall Street crash of 1929 had caused a huge worldwide depression. And like every financial crisis since the year dot, it was the working classes who were hit hardest. The northeast of England was particularly badly hit. In a small town called Jarrow, three quarters of the men were out of work and their families were literally starving. This entire town grew up around just one shipyard, Palmer's. So when the decision was taken to shut Palmer's down, it spelled disaster for everyone. And by 1936, the situation was desperate. 207 men set off on a march to London to ask the government for help.
The Jarrow petition, a petition to the government for work for the thousands of unemployed in what is probably the hardest hit town in Britain, is being carried to London by the 200 members of the Jarrow Crusade.
I've come to Jarrow to meet the children of those remarkable men and the legend that is Con Shields, who joined his father on the march into London. Mr. Shields.
Hello.
It's lovely to meet you. In keeping with tradition, Con Junior has brought along his own son today. That's Con Junior Junior.
He's a canny lad, I've got to say. He's bigger than me.
Is he always like this?
Yep.
How old?
Jeff, you know.
How old are you now?
96.
No. 96? Good God. I tell you, you're looking well on it.
Yeah.
You're looking well. Con, I've got some films here and some footage I'd like to show you. The Tyne was once a thriving port, and the launch of a new ship at Jarrow brought the whole community together. This was the HMS York.
I remember that. I was standing in York Avenue with a little flag.
Oh.
Hey.
God. When Palmer's closed, so did Jarrow.
That's the way it was. Men used to stand on street corners. There was nothing for them to do.
Look at the pawnbrokers.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
I've lost one of the balls there.
Is the pawn that close?
What was it like in Jarrow during that period? Pretty grim, I should imagine.
It was grim, yeah. I mean.
Everybody helped everybody.
Yeah. Oh, did they? Yeah.
Spirit of community there.
Yeah.
Anybody was making anything, like food, studies, you know, and things like that. They would give it to the neighbour and help each other.
And my dad, Paul, he left three kids with my mother, two daughters and a son. He had to go prize fighting for to get money.
Good God.
Before I was on the march, in the use of railways every day, I was in London at the time.
Yeah.
Well, I've got them all there.
Have you still got all the letters?
Well, he's got them all.
Oh, here you go.
He's got them. Are these your father's letters? Where is he? He's in Nottingham here.
That was on the march.
Yeah, yeah. So he'd stop off and he'd sit down and write a letter.
I see.
One of the letters, he had no paper, so he turned it over, wrote it on the pack and sent it back to him.
Oh yeah, P.S. Con.
Oh, there's one good one.
That's it.
There's one good one.
That's it.
Yeah. No paper left, so
I know, it's written on the back. It says here. It says, P.S. Con, I have no paper, so I have to write you on your letter, Father. Ah. God, these are wonderful, these. Look at this. Look. He's written that Wednesday Luton.
Edgeware.
Marble Arch.
That's where I met them.
Down at Marble Arch.
At Marble Arch.
London at last. The Jarrow Crusaders must be glad to have reached the end of their 300-mile trek, despite the rain in town.
Every place I went to brought that, you know, they brought that back to be kind to them.
Yeah.
But when they got there, they wanted nothing to do with them, the government.
Not one person come in to see them.
That's shocking.
And that they turn around again and go.
But it did do one thing for Jarrah. It brought them on the map. And
that's right.
No, it got them, yeah. Got them on the map.
It made people aware of what was going on in Jarrow.
Yeah.
I was told at school that the Jarrow Crusade was a failure for the working classes, but I was wrong. Yeah, all right, the government didn't listen, but the people of Britain did. The image of those men marching with such dignity and pride changed public opinion of the working class forever.
The things that we have to treasure, and the people, you know, who marched, and their wonderful contribution to our lives and the enrichment they've all brought us. So what we really, you know, as a billionaire couldn't buy.
Yeah.
What we have, what we've learned, and what's made us the people we are.
Well, I just feel very humbled at meeting those remarkable people, and remarkable they are as well. And they gave me this, is really what's upset me, to tell you the truth. They've given me their medals, and these are the medals that celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Jarrow Crusade. And I can't tell you how touched I am by that, and what a privilege it was to meet them. In the end, it wasn't the government who got Jarrow back to work. It was Hitler. War needs weapons. So men went from being in the dole queue one day to working 16 hours the next. And it wasn't just the men who were powering the war effort. The women of Britain transformed the workplace almost overnight.
The way of the world in wartime is very strange, and it might be said that the ways of women are strange too.
Now, Miss Stetch, would you like to go for munitions as well?
Yes, I would. I would like to make one big bomb so as to polish off that there man.
All the day long, whether rain or shine, she's a part of the assembly line. She's making history, working for victory, Rosie.
Welding? Nah, no problem.
Sabotage, sitting up there.
Bit of gear to carry in or riveting? Bring it on.
More than a male can do, Rosie.
That's it, love. You have a good swallow to take. You can't beat a rub down with an oil rag for the complexion. My Auntie Chrissy went off to Norfolk and trained to be a height and range finder for the men who worked the AK-AK guns. Having the sharp eye of an accomplished darts player, she found this no problem. earning herself the moniker Never Miss Chris. By the time the war was over, Auntie Chris swapped her uniform for that of a Clippies and returned to a life on the Birkenhead buses.
In their new uniforms, they present a smart and very pleasantly efficient appearance. Bus queues look like being longer than ever in the near future.
The Clippies were the epitome of glamour, and none more so than my Auntie Chris. She never appeared in public without that perfectly coiffed hair, a full face of slap, and a woodbine hanging from her lower lip. Chrissy was the pride of the Birkenhead Bus Company, and this is the depot where she would start her working day. And today, it's where I'll be starting mine.
It's a job that I've always wanted. Well, it was what I wanted when I was a little boy, and that as a conductor on the buses. And there is no good turning up on the buses looking scruffy. I mean, I should have ironed this shirt, but my jacket will hide it, so it doesn't matter. There you go. You didn't have gel then. Water or Brill cream. There you are. Any fares, please?
The double act of the wisecracking Clippy and the driver are long gone. And so is the old uniform, more's the pity. You see, when I was a kid, pride in your appearance meant pride in your job. And Auntie Chrissy considered that working on the buses was akin to being in show business. You were polished, professional, and you never let the mask slip. Good morning, gentlemen.
How are you?
I'm very well. I'll tell
you
what.
Lovely to meet you.
I'm all the better for seeing this beauty.
Yes. Oh. You've travelled on them.
What?
Number 60 would be your
number 60 up to Church Road, but the 79 was me. Yeah. How are you doing? Nice
to meet
you.
Norman's name.
No, I figured out it would be the 60.
Try this, Paul. See if it fits you. Yeah. Let's have a look. Oh, perfect. Yeah. Perfect.
It's a bit short in the sleeves. Well, yeah. Look, it looks like I've come for the job.
We'll get no tricks out of you then.
That's right. There'll be no peddling.
Step aboard.
I haven't been on one of these for years. Now, if you said to me, describe a bus, this is a bus, a blue and yellow Birkenhead bus.
That's right, yeah.
A proper bus.
And a lovely blue.
A gorgeous blue. And it even smells like a bus. There's a whiff of ciggy smoke in here and leather, you know, and what a bus should smell like, in sweat and copper.
Right, so this needs to go on to... I'm doing the opposite.
Your right shoulder.
Is that my money bag?
That's your money bag. You got your float in it. Check your float.
How much float did you get?
About a fiver.
A fiver?
Yeah.
No, 5 shillings.
Five shillings, sorry.
5 shillings.
5 shillings.
There's my float.
Well, you put this on the other side.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Right.
God, it is heavy, isn't it? So what do I do first?
Well, first of all, you stand there position. So you're out the way.
Yeah.
Two bells to go.
You ready?
Yeah. Hold tight, please.
Hold tight, please.
If you weren't listening, you should know when he fell down the stairs.
That's it, yeah. Straight. So, but he weren't told.
I had a push here, go straight off the New Ferry bypass, straight off and down a bypass. Now, what you have to do is, underneath there, there's a lock. Can you feel it?
Oh, yeah. Hang on. Yeah.
You'll get used to it. That's it, and there's your ticket.
Tricky, isn't it? Yeah. It looks, isn't it?
But the date's wrong, so you need to set the date on the bottom there.
Oh, my God, I didn't know you had to do all this.
Those dials there tell you what stage you're at. And every 3 stages, you have to book up.
Journey I don't remember all this. It's a big responsibility, isn't it?
That's right. People's lives on this platform, all down to you.
Well, I'm not sure about that. Well, if you can't do it, O'Grady, you shouldn't have written in, should you? Because today, you're going to be a conductor on your own bus. A modern one, though, more's the pity. This is what they used to do, what I used to love. I'll show you this now. This is fabulous. So the bus would be coming into Woodside and they'd lean right back and they'd go...
That's right.
And then they'd walk all calm like that. And we used to think it was the height of cool.
And in the summer, they'd all be sat on the wall.
That's it, all along the fag on. Yeah, it was fabulous. I mean... Well, Birkenhead, prepare yourselves, because me, Bob and Norman are going to bring a bit of that old-school glamour back to the buses. What's your name?
I'm Mal.
I am Mal. I'm your trainee for today. You do the short straw, and I'm very sorry. Take it out, Mal. I'm having no messing on my bus today.
Good.
I'm going to take a leaf out of my auntie's book and give them the poisonous look. Look at this shower here. Does that baby cry? Not on my route, love. Come on, all in, please.
Where's the bell?
I don't have to tell, I don't have to ring it, do I? I can just tell you.
Not these days.
Hold tight. Get your purses out, please, and get your money ready. What's that? This is 1960. This hasn't been invented yet. Mal, stop the bus. We've got a joker here. Throw him off. Jesus, Mal. You're breaking stiff there, aren't you? I came down there like a whippet on lino. Where are you going, love?
Woodchurch all the way.
Woodchurch all the way.
There you go.
Hey, Paul, where's our dinner?
Where are you going, love?
I'm going to get to New Brighton.
Oh, are you? You're on the wrong bus if you're going to New Brighton. Where are you going, love?
I'm definitely going all the way.
You're going all the way. You've got a woman on the back here going all the way in the office.
Definitely. You're very smart in your uniform.
Oh, I feel it. Yeah, it does, doesn't it? I miss my vocation. Do you ever remember the old Clippies, anyone? Yeah. Weren't they fabulous?
Yes.
But they were funny, weren't they? I always remember them as being funny and glamorous. Oh, what? Were you a Clippy? What route were you on?
70s, Crank Circle, where we're going.
Did you like it being a Clippy on the buses?
Loved it.
Yeah, she.
Husband was my driver.
Oh, was he?
Yeah.
Oh, how fabulous.
Yeah.
And were you all glammed up when you
I
would...
was. Yeah. I used to go to the hairdresser every day. I had a false piece made up with all, like, petals. I had my slants and jeans.
So you never saw a scruffy Clippy,
no,
did you?
No.
They were always, they were like film stars.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, the respect.
Yeah.
Like, we wouldn't dare give them cheek.
Oh, no. I threw many one off the my bus. And
yeah.
Me cheek.
That's right.
Where?
What?
Who is?
I'm Eva Ryden.
The girl from New Brighton.
She said she was our fare and all. Stop the bus! We've got a woman here, won't pay her fare. And she's got another woman with her who's got trouble written all over her face.
I think
she's been drinking, I can smell it on her breath. She's had baby sham, haven't you?
Oh, I love baby sham.
Yeah, I told you. It was a job to have, wasn't it? And it was a job to be proud of.
It was, and people had respect for you.
That's
then.
Right, loads of respect.
Know. Yeah.
Yeah. Ah, respect. That cornerstone of working class culture. It was all I ever heard when I was growing up. You had to respect your elders, your teacher, the police, the doctor, the man in the corner shop, pretty much anyone, really. The working class stuck together and looked after their own. Unless, of course, you were black.
They're a nuisance at work, they won't work.
They're not clean.
We want to keep Britain, keep it white as it should be.
The point is that whilst we can obtain white labour in this city, we intend to go on engaging white labour rather than coloured labour.
50 years ago, there was a colour bar on the buses in Bristol. If you weren't white, then you couldn't work. Simple as that. So I've come to St. Paul's, the heart of the West Indian community here, to meet four men who changed all that. Paul Stevenson, Roy Hackett, and Guy Reid-Bailey. Oh, and Labour MP and personal hero, Tony Benn, who was an important supporter of their campaign. Listen, thank you for taking time out.
You're so welcome.
How long have you been in this country?
60 years. On the 13th of October, which is gone.
60 years?
Yes, all my youth.
And what was Bristol like in the 60s? What was the attitude like in the 60s? You tell me.
It was tough.
Yeah.
I had bricks, bottles, stones, get out nigger, go home. All the terrifying things that I couldn't believe was happening.
I didn't expect the steel bands. I just want to be welcome in a home.
Yeah.
And then the sign says, no Irish, no gypsy, no black.
Yes. Now, how insulting is that when you'd been invited to this country?
Well, it was very degrading to me, actually, you know, especially when you think you were born British.
Yeah.
You know, your passport was British at the top and Jamaican down the bottom. And I thought, what a disgrace.
Yeah. Thousands of West Indians arrived in Britain after the war looking for work. But the welcome that they received was far from warm. In the white working class communities that they found themselves, people were suspicious and often outright hostile. My dad had it pretty bad when he arrived from Ireland, but it was nothing compared to this.
English workers have harboured racial prejudice most of their life.
Yeah.
Because of the culture and the history.
The British Empire. Mm-hmm. We were taught that we had the right to govern the world. We governed India, we governed Pakistan, we governed Jamaica. We took them over by force, and they were subjects to us. And therefore, in our thinking generally, our national culture, was the idea we were better than them.
So when you all arrived in Bristol, what jobs were available to black people at the time?
A job like cleaning in hospitals.
Yeah.
And working in restaurant, washing plates and so forth, but you've never get a job up front.
No.
No, neither in a store nor any shop. Matter of fact, you could even serve in a pub.
I think we tend to see Britain in the 60s as some kind of groovy liberal loving, but that's just not true. Yeah, okay, London might have been swinging to the sounds of Jimi Hendrix, but in Bristol, being black was definitely not cool.
Well, we don't want them on here, that's the main reason.
If we don't get our bit of overtime, we can't live. If they come down here, they'll work all hours God give them.
Around about that time was when the civil rights movement in America was really...
warming up.
Yeah, warming up.
I thought, why don't we have a boycott, as Luther King's doing? And that's how it began.
So the people of Bristol and they listened and they joined in the boycott, they wouldn't get the bus.
Oh yeah, quite a number of
them. That was great then, wasn't it?
Oh yeah.
The big support we also had was from the university students as well.
Bristol University.
Yeah.
We marched down Park Street, brought traffic to a standstill.
Now, Mr. Bent, you supported this boycott wholeheartedly, didn't you? Because
Paul approached me.
Yeah.
And I supported it immediately. Then I spoke to Harold Wilson. He became Prime Minister the following year. He supported it, and after that, the thing really began to take off.
The battle against racialism here in Britain knows no boundaries and no limits.
After just 60 days, the boycott succeeded, and on the 28th of August, the bus company hired their first non-white conductor, a Sikh called Ragbir Singh. It was a big day for civil rights. Across the pond, Martin Luther King was leading the Washington March for Jobs and Freedom, giving his now famous speech, I Have a Dream.
Mr. Paul Stevenson, you're the young man who brought the whole of this business to public notice. You've now read the agreed statement between the company and the unions. What are your views on it?
Well, of course, we're very pleased indeed. I think this is going to be welcomed by coloured people all over Bristol and many, many Bristolians who came in and gave us their sympathy.
Had it not been for those days, we wouldn't have achieved what we have over the last 30, 40 years. And I think they have to say thank you to people like Paul, Tony, because it was then that the first Race Relations Act ever come into being.
And was that, Mr. Ben, a result of the success of the boycott?
He changed the culture.
Yeah.
People began to realise that what was going on was wrong.
The establishment was changing.
Yeah.
You could now apply to go into the police force. You could become a fireman, which you couldn't be before the boycott.
But, Paul, you must accept credit to yourself. I mean, progress historically is made when people do things, and you did something.
Well, I think we all really fall together on this one. We've got a long way to go.
Pulling together is a recurring theme for the working class, it seems, and never more so than down the mines. Come on, you didn't think I was going to make a film about the working class without meeting these lads, did you? Mining was the backbone of British industry. These were tough men doing a tough job. But the terrible conditions only made them stronger. By the 70s, the miners' union showed just how powerful the working class had become. I always admired the miners, all my family did. So I've come to the National Coal Mining Museum in Yorkshire to find out what made those underground communities so special. I'm looking for the miner.
Here you are. How are you doing, Paul? Are
you Andy?
Oh, yep.
Hi, you're Andy.
Welcome
nice
to the mining
to meet
museum.
You. Thank you
come,
very much.
Come to the heartbeat of our community.
Right,
yeah. Our tea room.
It's a few more, isn't it?
So what do you want in your tea?
Hey?
What do you have in your tea?
One sugar, please. Oh, and milk.
You're sweet enough, are you?
Not really.
So, sit down, Paul.
So how's it going here?
Very well.
Yeah?
Very well.
What was it like down the mines?
Dark and dusty.
Dark and wet.
How old were you when you were first went down the pit?
15 and a half.
And did you want to go down?
Don't want much else.
Yeah, that was it. That was job opportunity.
I was pony driving at 16.
Were you? Yeah, you grew up quick, didn't you, up here?
On face, I'm filling.
Yeah. What's filling?
Filling 18 tonne of coil a day off at 18.
And that's
I was
by
just
hands.
18, oh, yeah. Right.
Shovel, you'll have a go at that later on.
Oh,
right. We've only got 20 for you, though, haven't we?
Were there many accidents down there, you know, with mines
collapsing? There were a lot of accidents, but there were a lot more that walked away from it without any injuries.
They say outlaws in mining are written with miners' blood because we've had to find out what's gone wrong to stop it happening again.
It was the miners' union that fought for laws to protect the men. And they wielded real power. It was the strikes in the 70s that brought down Ted Heath's Conservative government. The union was really strong then, wasn't it? It seemed to me all the members thought as well.
Yes, you're right there, but you have to also think at least 50% of the country depended on coal for power.
Exactly. Yeah.
So we've got them with short and curly, haven't we?
That's right, yeah.
The power went off and the lights went out and all the people knew then, didn't they? There was something happening.
Yeah. The Conservatives didn't forget, though. Margaret Thatcher was waiting in the wings, ready to take on the miners' union. Well, to take on the working class, to be honest.
They got prepared for the next one, didn't they?
Oh, too right. I think there was a bit of revenge going there for the...
I think not a bit, a lot.
Yeah, no, I think it was. But there was a great respect, still is, for the miners, you know, because hard working, dirty job, dangerous. That's how we all saw it.
Yeah, it is.
I think I should go down, Andy, and
have
a look.
Let's go have a go. Yeah. You need some tackle first.
All right, then.
From filling coal to washing coats.
Right, Andy.
See you.
Gives me gear.
You need an helmet,
yeah,
a lamp, and an old oil lamp. Mick will see you to you.
Cheers, mate.
And he needs flame safety, right, lamp, mate.
Deputies here.
Here's your lamp, Paul.
Thanks very much.
Little orange flame. If there's any gas, blue triangle appears on the top of it.
Oh, does it?
Yeah.
Oh, so it tells you if there's any methane around or anything.
Yeah. That's it.
Now you look like a miner now.
OK. Nice. See you later.
See you later. Go on.
Hi-ho! They're the only miners I know, seven dwarfs.
Two from the ground. Thank you.
Thank you. This is it, Andy.
This is it, yeah. We're on our way to the coal face, what we call the Russian front. So we're on our way in by now.
Yeah.
That means it ain't at mine.
Is this the coal face?
This is where we're going to go, so we need coat off.
Okay.
Just take it off here, alright?
Yeah.
Miners face this every day. Oh, God, blimey, what are you doing there?
Don't know. It's my first day on the job.
Are you fully trained?
No, it's my first day. You've got to show me. You're telling me upstairs I have to stick with an owl lag who knows what to do.
You do. Are we going?
Yeah.
Are you fit for it? Come on.
I am. This would sort the men out from the boys down here.
All right, will I?
And how long would you be on your knees for?
A minimum of 6 hours.
6 hours? You must have been crippled by it when you came out.
That's why a lot of miners suffer from bad knees and beat knee and beat elbow.
Right, Andy, I've got me pick.
Yeah, this is what you're going to pick.
So this is the coal face?
This is the coal face, yeah. And then you need to be sideways on.
Like that?
That's it, yeah.
and then attack it.
Get yourself comfortable.
Get myself comfortable down here.
Are you left-handed or right-handed?
Right-handed.
Oh, that's just fine.
God, it's hard work, isn't it?
You see, you get the hang of it now.
Do you know when you got stripped off down here, Andy, because of the heat?
Yeah.
There must have been some horrific scarring went on.
Oh yeah, yeah. If you got a scar,
and you got coal in it,
you used to be left with a blue scar. That was forever, like a tattoo.
I bet there's a few fellas round Yorkshire with backs on them like Stilton. Hey, Andy.
Yeah?
I've been going for hours here now.
Right, we'll have a snap time, Paul.
Can we?
20 minutes.
20 minutes.
20 minutes. Here's your snap tin.
Ta.
For 20 minutes. It's a different world.
Do you want a bit?
No, I'm all right, mate.
You sure?
Why?
It's nice and comfy.
Nice and comfy, yeah. Peaceful now, isn't it?
I see what you mean about the camaraderie down here.
Oh, yeah.
You'd have to, though, wouldn't you?
Oh,
you've
got
to look after each other.
That's right, Friend for life.
That's right. Well, you'd make friends for life down here.
Yeah.
You'd have to. There's something very soothing about being underground.
I like being underground. I love it underground because the banter is absolutely out of this world.
I mean, we might not all be related anymore, but that sense of humour and that camaraderie is still there and very, you know, very strong between us, yeah.
Keeps you jovial.
This great underground community was about to come apart at the seams. In 84, the miners went on strike again, but this time, things were different. The government had stockpiled coal, and the strike ended up lasting a year. Men crossed the picket line, and violence broke out across the country. Thatcher had taken on the most iconic of the working-class industries and won. The writing was on the wall. This great mine has been consigned to history, and a strong union like the Miners' Union was broken. And that, for me, was the beginning of the end of the working classes. And if you don't mind, I'm off for a shower. Thank you. Wait for me, fellas. Who's got the soap?
It was just such a community spirit, and then, obviously, the strike happened.
It used to be when Castleford used to be full of mines.
After the strike, they all shut, so it decimated the entire area.
Then as pits shut, people started moving out.
The shops shut and it was a tough time.
It still cuts deep, but that's life, I suppose.
This was the biggest crisis the working class had faced. Working the clubs around Yorkshire, I saw firsthand the damage that was done. The clubs either closed down or stopped booking entertainment. One by one, the shipyards closed. Manufacturing jobs were sent abroad, and the working class stopped working. Or at least they stopped working in the jobs that had defined them. We don't really make very much anymore. We sell, and then we tell you what to do with the stuff we've just sold you. 1 million people in Britain now work in call centres. They've even built these shiny new offices on top of the old industries. I've come to visit O2 in Finiston in Glasgow. Working class people used to build ships here. I want to see if any of those strong values and working class pride has survived now that the old shipyards have disappeared.
Good morning, Paul.
Hi, are you Karina?
My name's Karina, yes. I'm here to give you your tour of O2 and your induction.
Thank you.
Great to have you here.
Thank you very
much.
Here's
a pass we've got all made up for you. Our induction normally can last anything from 4 weeks onwards.
Really?
Yeah, but I've organised a wee bit of training for you today with one of my team.
For about 5 days.
This is where you're going to be working?
It's not anything as I imagined this. I thought everyone was like battery hens.
No.
You know, all partitioned off in little booths.
Nope, not at all. So what we will see is everybody's actually got wireless headsets. So even when they're on the phone to the customers, they're able to stand up and freely talk to them.
Oh, so you're not bound to your desk?
Absolutely not. So as well, we've got the plasma screens out. We'll have any big sporting events. So we'd have
Hi, Anna.
Hi.
Nice
Hiya.
To meet nice you. Meet you. Nice you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Are you ready
sorry.
For this?
Are you?
No. Is that right?
John, you can put that way.
Daddy, yeah. How does Madonna handle these things?
We ready to go?
Yeah. Hello, is that Mavis?
Yes, it is.
Hello, Mavis. How are you getting on with your phone?
I'm fine, very good, thank you very much.
Yeah, no problems.
None at all.
Cheers, Mavis, thank you, bye.
Bye.
Should you try to a flog or something?
No. So the next customer we can phone is, she's called Leslie.
Leslie. Hello, is that Leslie?
It is, yeah.
Hello, Leslie, it's Paul here from the O2.
Yeah, I recognise your voice.
You might recognise my voice, yeah.
Who is it, Paul O'Brien?
I'm afraid it is, yeah, but I'm working in the O2 call centre today.
Oh, are you?
Yeah.
What did you mean when you said Paul? Oh.
Yeah. Bye, Leslie. Bye. Shouldn't seem the least bit surprised that I was on the phone in the call centre. I'm not the slightest suspicious. Must always probably, you know, give it all up.
I know, yeah. Started this new
moved,
job.
Moved to Glasgow and was waiting in the call centre.
I know. No, she seemed happy.
If I moved to Glasgow, I wouldn't be able to get up on the phones, believe you me.
Hey, what would you be doing?
I'd be in a body bag here like this. We've been on the phone too long now. I think we should go and have a cup of tea.
Okay, come on.
Get your pass. We're not eating today.
Uh-huh.
No, we're just having them.
Two cans.
I'm brew.
150, thanks.
Ta. Hiya.
Hi.
Hiya. Been waiting all morning. Been on the phone. It's not how I imagined it at all. And realising that the skill that's required to work in a call centre.
I think there's sometimes we stigma against call centres that they think that they're just coming through to somebody who doesn't know what they're talking about. But we do, and as I say, we're problem solving all the time. So I love working here. I would rather have
nice
left
place.
And done this yeah. rather than wasting my time in uni, because you don't get anything at the end of it, really.
There's over 1 million people now working in call centres. And that was in the 40s, that was what was working down the mines. What I want to know is, you know, down the mines there's this great community spirit and all this, and we all stick together and look out for each other. It's the same going on here in the present day.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. Like, do people meet and marry and all this, and, you know, in the workplace? Oh, did you? Oh, smashing.
We've got a 2-year-old son as well.
So. Oh, really? Yeah. Got that. When did you meet?
About 4 years ago.
That was quick, wasn't it? No messing there.
just in the door.
Foot in the door, baby on the floor. There you go.
That's it.
Yeah, no, well, that's good. Can I ask you all something? Because this is what the programme's about. Do you consider yourselves working class?
I wouldn't say working class, no.
Are you middle class?
I don't even...
See, I think I'm working class.
Yeah.
Even though I've left, you know, I don't live in Birkenhead anymore. I don't live in my mum's two up and two down, but yeah. I still see myself as working class.
I don't know, nowadays obviously that's not something that people use, but if you were
no,
to put
they
it
don't,
in,
do they? Yeah.
If you're to put it in that context, then yeah, no, we are.
So, are you?
Well, not at all. I don't see class at all, to be honest. No. It's not anything I really ever kind of think about.
It's not a term used in our generation though.
So the younger generation now, you reckon class is out, all that's gone?
And it's not really considered a issue for someone in our generation.
It's how you present yourself as a person.
That's
more
right.
than anything.
Yeah.
It's how you are. If you give people respect, they're going to give you it back, and it doesn't matter where you come from.
Yeah. Now, what happened if Lady So-and-so came in?
Wouldn't she be any different, to be honest?
She's the same, yeah.
See, I'd probably put a posh voice on. Because old habits die hard. So I've learnt a lot in here today, tell you the truth. Especially about class. It's one for all and all for one in here, that's it, yeah. And it's lovely that you don't feel that there's any classes.
Are you
going to
go down to customer services and take some calls in there?
I don't think you want me in customer service. I'd say stop moaning, for God's sake, it's a phone. It's not a unit for a premature baby. You'll survive through the night. I'm pleased that Anna and her mate at O2 don't feel held back or defined by class. But to me, it isn't something we should be running away from. The working class have taken a real battering over the past few decades, so much so you can barely see them. But they are still there. I've started since I've been doing this, so if I get in a cab, I say to the cab driver, because I'm very chatty with cab drivers, I always say to them, do you consider yourself working class? And they not only go yes, they say it defiantly and proudly. Of course I am. There's a Portuguese cafe I like going in. It's a Portuguese family run it. And I said to them, are you working class? Yes, we are. We are workers, we work, yeah. So yes, there is, there's a really, there's a solid bedrock of working class people in this country. And I keep saying this, who are much maligned and mocked and overlooked, in fact, who work like Trojans to support themselves and their family. You know, cabbies doing 14 hours a day. And people in factories doing extra shifts. Yes, there's a thriving working class. I firmly believe the younger generation don't. They consider themselves classless. But watch as they get older. They'll soon find themselves a slot that they fall into. I'm working class. It is a badge of pride. It's about this, not about that, and about where you live. It's about a set of values and the way you see and the way you conduct your business and the way you treat people. That, to me, are the working classes. So next week, I'm going home to find out how our lives outside of work had just as big a part to play in shaping our working class values and our sense of humour. Thank you.